Standing by my side. Sir, I'm not sure who you are, but you want to take Sunday school this morning?
It's good to see everybody. Good to be back in Monroe. I love down home, but I don't know where. My brother was critically ill. I went down, he died. We buried him on Monday, there was a little car up on Tuesday morning. Took me 3 weeks to get it fixed. Had to replace the engine in the car, so I'm thankful to be back in Monroe. I missed the church. I hope you missed me a little bit.
Whole lot.
I know. I try to do what I can. I think my race is running down. But I would like to leave here with a clean record. We got down to the 13th chapter of Exodus. Now, as we look at these things, much of the Old Testament's in types and shadows, and we decide what these things are shadows of or types of in the New Testament, since our understanding is not perfect, it is possible sometimes that me and you, or you and you, might have a little bit different perception. If we get God's mind, we'll have the same understanding. But we can look at these things and we can find parallels where they fulfill in the church what happened to them in the Old Testament. Now, they were in slavery in Egypt, bondage, ill-treated. Now, me and you, the representation, we were sinner folks. We were in a bondage to sin that on our own we could not escape. God delivered us from the bondage of sin just as much as he physically delivered the Hebrew people from the bondage of slavery in Egypt. Without God's assistance, we never would have come out. We never repented. We have never been able to bring our heart to save repentance. We could bring our heart to cry. We could bring down the sorrow. We could grieve. We could scream. But we never did have the control over our hearts to make it submit to God. Only through God's help. I believe Stevie preached here one day and said, if I can get it right in my mind, without conviction, he didn't believe in no conversion. And what we really, God's Spirit must draw you. All you do is believe and obey. You repent. But the saving is done by God. He completely is what saves us. If we were left to ourselves, we could work our whole lives and we'd be just as lost when the end comes where it was when we started. But God loved us. Now the illustration here, he begins to teach the 13th chapter of Exodus. And Lord spake unto Moses, saying, sanctify unto me all the firstborn, whatsoever opened the womb among the children of Israel, both of men and beasts, it is mine. Now, I think these are comparisons to teaching examples of what we're to observe in the Spirit. God is due first. Now, this is a lot of times a problem with Christian folks. We get saved and we put the pleasure in itself may not be sin. But we put the pleasure in position that it holds first joy in our life. Some people, now I'm not knocking fishing, but some people can't hardly come to church to go and fishing. Some people can't hardly come to church because they've got to go camping. I'm not against camping. What I'm saying is, without all pleasures, God is to come first. He does not accept second place. Sanctify to me the firstborn whatsoever of the womb among the children of Israel, both of man and of beast, it is mine. And Moses said unto the people, remember this day in which you came out of Egypt, out of the house of bondage, for by strength of the hand of the Lord brought you out of this place. There shall be no leavened bread eaten. Now there's a great lesson here that tells Moses speaks to people and says, you remember this day. God delivered you from the bondage of Egypt. We can take it down to the Christian. Remember that day that God delivered you from the bondage of sin. Now, without a doubt, across the world is untold numbers of people who pray in time of trouble and get saved. But not all of them seem to be willing to remember that day. And to, now, you're not to eat no unleavened bread. There shall be no unleavened bread eaten. Now, in the fifth chapter of Corinthians, I believe it says, along about verse 8, how that Christ is our Passover. He is our deliverance. Through him, we are delivered. And we are to eat the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. Now, here we get into a problem, but we get ourselves into trouble at times. Sometimes we let leaven get in our lives. Now, unleavened bread is simply bread without any mixture in it. Nothing in it that shouldn't be there. In the 18th chapter of Revelations, God speaks to the Christian people. He says, come out of her, my people, speaking of Mystery Babylon. Don't partake of her sins. Sometimes we as Christians, we get tempted to do things we know we should not do. And sometimes we give in. And absolutely without a question, we pay the price for it. There is no doubt, there is no doubt. When we begin to eat leavened bread, spiritually speaking, we begin to mix in our lives the things that does not belong there. It will have its effect. There is always a reward for doing wrong, as there's a reward for doing right. Now, I said, remember this day. And it shall be when the Lord shall bring thee out of the land of Egypt, the land of the Canaanites, and Hittites, and Amorites, and Hittites, and Jezreelites, and he which he sware unto thy fathers to give thee a land flowing with milk and honey, that thou shalt keep this service in this month. Now, no one could imagine that when they went into the land of Israel, that they come up to a lake, a river, literally milk and honey flowing down it. This is, I don't know, I'm not good at words and things, but this is a form of showing how God is blessing them with the abundance of the land. Now, God has blessed me and you with the abundance of Christianity. It is a country of milk and honey. But we can choose what we eat. Christ said, except you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you have no life in you. Now, quite often people make such a keeping the Lord's Supper, where I do believe in keeping the Lord's Supper. But I believe eating the flesh of the Lord and drinking his blood is walking in the Spirit of holiness before God. We are to live in Christ. We're to be fed through Christ. We're to be, actually, we were delivered by his blood. This is a spiritual thing. If we have spiritual life, we have it only in Christ. There's no life in this world as far as the salvation of the soul. 7 days thou shalt eat unleavened bread, and the seventh day shall be a feast of the Lord. Now, why the Lord uses seven so much, I won't argue with anybody, but I do think Selah is a symbol of completion. 7 days thou shalt eat unleavened bread. Now, me and you, I think this is only a symbol of what we should do every day. Every day we should eat the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. Ain't got nothing about what's written on the door up there, Pentecostal, Baptist, Methodist, Presbyterian, Lutheran. I ain't talking about that. I'm talking about what lives in our hearts, what we absorb, what we spiritually eat. Now, you know, Stephen M. will talk about feeding the flock. Come here, preach till you feed the flock. But you ever try to eat, feed something and wouldn't eat it? I don't care how many preaches. It's up to you what you do about it. It's your choice. You know, God don't, but He tells us what to do, but He allows us to make our own decisions. Now then, 7 days thou shalt eat unleavened bread, and in the seventh day shall be a feast of the Lord. Unleavened bread shall be eaten 7 days, and there shall be no leavened bread be seen with thee, neither shall there be leaven seen with thee in all thy quarters. Now they had a system, I understand. They went through the house and they made sure all the leaven was, you know, just like we go through the house, we sweep all the dirt out of there. They made sure all the leaven was out. Me and you need to make sure that if we know it's wrong, we put it out of our lives. The Bible says, lay aside sin and wait. That's so easily besets you. If you know it's wrong, and if you're tempted, more than likely most people have places they recognize that they are kind. Stay away from it. Don't go around it. Don't be there fooling with it. Because if you do, likelihood you'll partake of it. And don't make provisions to sin. Now, I don't mean to step on nobody's toes. I was down at Mark's house. He's got a television. I watch television quite a bit down there. I watch the news. I got sick of it. But I don't have a television. And there's a reason for it. I found myself sitting around bored, tempted to watch things that I know I shouldn't watch. So, Janice and I made a choice. You said, well, you're going to tell me I can't go to heaven if I got a television? No, I'm going to tell you that. But I don't believe people go to heaven long with sin. And you have a choice if you said you. Abstain from the appearance of evil. If it's something that's going to problem to you, get rid of it. Get it out of your life. I don't care what the other folks doing. If it is something that you see is causing you problems, you get rid of it. And that's the enlightened bread of sincerity too. Remember what Jesus told us of the Samaritan woman? When he said, give me a drink of water. She said, people put so much emphasis on that, which is true, it's a great scripture. How he said, if you'd ask me, I'd give you a drink of living water. But they go on in their conversation, and you know, he asks her about her husband. She said, well, I don't have one. He said, well, you've had five husbands. And the one you now have is not your husband. And I want to tell you a little story to show how easy it is for us to blind ourselves if we want to believe something a certain way. I was sitting in a particular church, and there was a man preaching. And he mentioned this particular scripture. Now, consider one. He said, how many husbands has she had? One. But see what the Lord said? Thou hast had five husbands. But this particular church didn't believe you could go to heaven if you'd been married twice. So he was so wrapped in his doctrine that he led, blind him to what the Lord plainly said. You've had five husbands and a man you now got each other. But if you would ask of me, I'd save you. Now then, which I'm not issued about that, but the point is, make sure that we don't let our desires blind us to the truth. And if I have to prove something by going beyond exaggeration, I need to leave it alone. Just don't try to prove it. Now, unleavened bread shall be eaten 7 days, and there shall be no leavened bread seen with thee, neither shall there be leavened in all thy quarters. And thou shalt show thy son in that day, saying, this was done because of that which the Lord did unto me when I came forth out of the land of Egypt. You should always have the testimony in your heart to call the Lord. Why do you live like this? Because God saved my soul from sin. Because I got saved. God made a change. How many times have we heard preachers say, if there's no change, there's been no salvation? If you get saved, there will be a change. So if your son says in the Old Testament, why are you doing this? You know, he might say, I don't like bread with no salt in it. So why are you doing this? Why? Then you tell him about your deliverance from bondage. This is the thing with us. Why do you live like that? Why don't you cuss and swear no more? Why don't you lie no more? Why don't you tell no more filthy jokes? Ain't you willing to cheat your neighbor no more? Because God saved me. Because inwardly I'm a different person than I was before. And it shall be for a sign to thee unto thine hand, and for a memorial between thine eyes, that the Lord's law may be in thy mouth. For with a strong hand hath the Lord brought thee out of the land of Egypt. The Lord promised us in the Old Testament that the time would come that he would write his laws in our hearts, in our minds. I don't know what you read out of some book, I don't always read the book, but what is important with you? I can look at you. Do I know everything about you? No, I know very little. But God knows it all. He knows exactly what he wrote in your heart. And he will require it of you. That's where somebody said something about somebody dying. I said, well, I go up and look in the coffin and I say, I hope they made it. Why would you say that? I know if they made it, they done it for God's will. A simple thing. But I hope they found a way to make it. And thou shalt therefore keep this ordinance in this season from year to year. Now, as they've done so many things with you, they went down to the temple. But the Lord told the Samaritan woman, she said, where's the proper worship? And the temple in Jerusalem, our here in Samaria, is where our followers. Where should we worship? See, the time comes, and now is, the helmet worship God is worship in spirit and truth. Now, there is doctrinal teachings that there's prophecies in the Old Testament God will reveal, that the temple of God will be revealed.
What church?
I don't require nobody to believe what I believe. But I believe the church is the temple of God. God built the church from the cross, and that we are the temple. And when we consider this matter, of what use has God of the Jewish folks building a temple back over on Mount Zion? What matters? There's no salvation in that. Salvation lies in the blood of Jesus Christ. The temple, is to church. And if we're part of it, we're not made for him. And it shall be when the Lord shall bring thee into the land of the Canaanites, as he has sworn unto thee and to thy fathers, and shall give it thee, that thou shalt set apart unto the Lord all that opens the matrix, and every first one that cometh of the beast that has the males, as shall be the Lord's. And every first sin of an ass thou shalt redeem with a lamb, and if thou wilt not redeem it, then thou shalt break his neck, and all the firstborn men among the children shalt thou redeem. Now here is, to me, I understand this. God is first. Enough to go fishing, son. But I feel like going to church. My choice, your choice. Give God first. Give him time for you to go fishing. But put him first. Put his, you know, what value would Stevie be as a preacher if he's fishing every Sunday? What if, said, I'd love to preach to you, but I bought me a camper, and I had to go down in Ohio camping every weekend. Neither one of those things is of itself a sin. But our lives must be set up that God comes first. That God gets it first. And it shall be with thy son. Ask thee in time to come, saying, what is this? That thou shalt say unto him, I sent the hand, the Lord rose out of the land of Egypt, from the land of bondage. And it came to pass, when Pharaoh would hardly let us go, the Lord slew all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both the firstborn of men and the firstborn of beasts. Therefore I sacrifice to the Lord all that open the matrix, being males, but all the firstborn of my children I redeem. And it shall be a token upon thy hands and forelet before thine eyes, for the strength of the hand of the Lord brought us out of the land of Egypt. Now if we forget that God saved us, we'll go back and begin to live the life that we did before we got saved. Mama walking out over there, 15-year-old daughter, 14-year-old daughter. Mama walking out over. Why are you? She lets her daughter go. Why can't I go? Because God saved me. And it's my duty to teach you a life of Christianity. And it came to pass when Pharaoh had let the people go, that God led them not through the way of the land of the Philistines, although that was near. For God said, lest prevention the people repent when they see war, and they return to Egypt. Now, he conditioned them to make the journey and to succeed. In this going around, I'm not no great hand at the history, but it looks to me like the whole country, I'm always moving my place, going around from Egypt, up around through the countryside, going into Palestine. Dixie's boy went over to Iraq. He said he got up to 150 degrees where he was at sometimes in the daytime, but they was limited at the amount of water they could drink. They were on a ration. Think what God done. He took 600,000 men. Now if you take women and children to go along with this, and it makes multitude, historians think it could be 2 million, 3 million people. Plus,
and
abundance of
cattle.
You remember how much trouble the United States had giving water to their army in Iraq? how they had to scrounge up to get the water for these soldiers to drink. But God had 3 million people walking through the heat of the desert. And he fixed it so that they physically could make it. He gave them the water to drink. He fed them. But if you figure 3 million people, and you feed them 3 meals a day, that's 9 million meals a day. Of course, he could feed 9 million people just as well as he could 500. I heard a Jewish rabbi talking. He said, well, they weren't not many people. It was only about 25,000. Now, where he got that figure out, I don't know. The Bible said there's 600,000 men. But in other words, this was a documentary of the miracles of the Bible. And all it done was create unbelief. Because everything that the Bible says God done, they created an explanation why this happened in nature. Never did they say the hand of God done this. But you and I know God saved us. Listen, I know. I don't want to say something. Well, you both, you're only 16 years old. You both, no, I don't want to say it like that. I was either. But I was wrapped in sin. God delivered me in one night, one instant of time. It changed. Shamefully, I've said one filthy word since then. And that's nothing to brag about. God changed me that night. When we get asked, why are you like this? Because God saved me. Why don't you participate in this? Because I'm supposed to eat the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. I'm not supposed to just absorb anything that comes down the road. People are blinding themselves. They're blinding them so much that they're actually on the verge of destroying our country. Because they hate righteousness so bad that they're willing to swallow anything to destroy righteous standards as it has been in the United States. We are so fortunate they can't destroy our Christianity. They can't take it. We can give it up. But they say, okay, yeah. But they can't take it. They killed the apostles. According to the Fox's Book of Martyrs, which is a man-made history, written history, between 100 AD and 1800 AD, they figured they murdered about 50 million Christians. According to an update, they killed more between 1800 and 1900 than they did the previous 1800 years. So make no mistake, they're murdering Christians all the time. They're just censoring it out of the news. But with all that, God's hand keeps things restrained to the way he wants them. We can make it, but we'll not make it on our own strength. We'll make it on the strength of God. Just like the Hebrew people, they didn't come out of Egypt out of their own strength, their own wisdom. There was nothing mighty about them down there in slavery. But they came out of Egypt because God physically delivered them from the bondage of Egypt. Me and you got saved. I don't care what attribute you can look at about us. That had nothing to do with us getting saved. We only got saved because God loved us. And when he spoke to our hearts with conviction, we believed it and obeyed it. And it came to pass when Pharaoh had let the people go, that God led them not through the way of the land of Philistines, though that was near, for God said, let's prevent you. The people repent and they see the war, and they return to Egypt. But God led the people about through the way of the wilderness of the Red Sea, and the children of Israel went up, harassed out of the land of Egypt. And Moses took the bones of Joseph with him, for he had strictly sworn unto the children of Israel, saying, God will surely visit you, and you shall carry up my bones away hence. And they took their journey from Tachash, then encamped in Ehem, at the edge of the wilderness. Now they began their route as God told them to walk. Now, we got saved, but our environment is still shortcoming. It's still evil around us. But there's coming a time when the Lord will return and he will restore all things as they should be. It's Acts 3, I think 19:20-21. Now, I could debate with somebody, well, this is what's going to happen. This is how it's going to be. This is how it's going to be. My mansion's going to be close. All that stuff is just almost synonymous. The Bible says the Lord will return and restore all things. Soon spoke of Jesus who went up from the heavens must proceed until. Now, our journey one of these days is going to be over. And the only thing that will matter was, will we make it into heaven? That's the only thing that really matters. Now, I thought so much, the Lord delivered them physically out of the land of Egypt and said, I will give you this country. All they had to do was walk up there. When they got up there, they picked one spy from each of the tribes and sent them over into the country. They came back and 10 of the spies said, we can't do it. 2 said, we can. The people's hearts be healed. Because the crowd said they couldn't do it. Do you know each one of those people that failed to believe God that day did not have to go into the land of Canaan above the age of 20? God sent them out into the wilderness until all the people over 20 years old died except 2 men. The 2 spies that said we can take it. The rest of them fell by the wayside. They didn't go in. They didn't skip to see the rivers of milk flowing with milk and honey. They didn't get to absorb the vineyards was already planted. They didn't get that because they did not walk where God would have them to walk. When the Lord spoke to them, they refused to believe him. You can go in, I'm going to give this to you. And can you say, and I may be one, I'm having a hard time even sometimes walking. And sometimes my thinking slows down. But here was Caleb, 83 years old. He said, give me that mountain. I'm just as capable today as I was 40 years ago when I said to take it. That was faith. That man had faith in God. God has promised it to me. I'm 83 years old, but I can possess it. Faith like that. We're facing, unfortunately, if someone has their way in America, we're facing a dictatorship which will turn into Christianity. And Christianity will be outlawed unless you conform to the government's prescribed church. If you say, no, I believe Jesus is the Christ, you must believe on Jesus to be saved. You're going to be declared a baby, a troublemaker, a rabble rouser. And if you get about arguing about what you're going to call for Baptist and Methodist and Nazarene, they put all of you in the same boat. You're one of those radicals that believes Jesus is the way to salvation and only through Jesus. How many times have you heard Steve say, Jesus is not just the way, he's the only way. Do you know that's costing people their lives in some parts of the world when they cut stamina? And if we make it here, there are thousands and thousands of American people. They hate us. We've done nothing to them, but they hate us because they hate Christ. They hate Christ. There's one way to survive. Walk in the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. Jesus is our Passover. When he went to Calvary that night, he brought deliverance for me and you. Why do you